Nomenclature codes or codes of nomenclature are the various rule books that will govern a biological taxonomic nomenclature for different groups of organisms. And nowadays, there are several nomenclatorial codes which are essentially independent from one another. Okay? Yes, some may share a lot, but the discrepancies may also be extreme between each of these. And among the most prominent, we're going to talk about the International Code of Nomenclature for Algae, Fungi, and Plants, which replaced the International Code of Botanical Nomenclature in 2011. We have the International Code of Zoological Nomenclature, which still stands. We have an International Code of Nomenclature of Bacteria. And then we have International Committee for Viruses. And I want to tell you that there are additional codes, but which we did not deem to discuss here. Okay? So what are the objectives of nomenclatorial rules? The three main purposes of nomenclatorial rules, and this will hold basically for all taxa, may be borrowed from the introductory remarks of the International Code of Zoological Nomenclature. And we state that the object of the code is to promote stability and universality in the scientific names of animals and to ensure that each name is unique and distinct. And all the provisions of the code are subservient to this end. Basically, there are three keywords: stability, universality, and stability will simply mean that the name of organisms should be changed as little as possible. Actually, we'll say it should not be changed, but there are cases where we are compelled, for the sake of avoiding confusion, we are compelled to change some. Okay? Universality means that the same organism should be referred or known to everywhere in the world with the same name. If we did a little survey in this room and asked you the name of the dog in the language that you speak, we're probably going to live here with as many names as there are people gathered here. So there's a need to have at least a uniting name that will be shared among all scientists everywhere. And uniqueness will simply stand for the fact that no two animals or no two living organisms, I will not say that. No two organisms within a particular code, and we shall understand why, should share the same name. Okay? Good. So what are the general principles of biological nomenclature? And these principles are very important. Okay? And here they will essentially focus on the plants and animals, but will hold to all living organisms. Botanical and zoological codes are independent of each other. What is the implication? The implication is simply that an animal and a plant can have the same name, you will not be violating any rule. However, this is not desirable. Okay? It is not desirable at all. But if you did that, you will not be violating any rule. Thus, taxa within each code that are assigned to a certain categories may have only one correct name. Are you getting that? You may have several scientific names referring to the same organism, but only one of them is a valid name. All the others would be synonyms. Very important. The next one is that two taxa cannot have the same name. Okay? If they did, confusion. So we cannot take that. We're also going to say that all taxa names are treated as if they were Latin, independent of their language of origin. In general, the correct name is the earliest proposed name, and that is a principle we shall talk about again in a little while, the principle of priority. Okay? And for categories of superfamily and lower categories, all names are objectively defined in reference to the type genera. So for you to name a family, you must have within that family a name of a genus that will serve as the root for the name of the family. The most current codes are retroactive unless specifically stated. If the code, if the Congress of botany or zoology sat down and edited their rules and adopted new ones, they would be applied to all the organisms that have been named since the time of Linnaeus. Basically, that is one of these principles. And as such, we start talking about the name of living organisms. And we said previously that the name of living organisms is made up of two portions. Of course, this will apply to living organisms, and we don't want to consider viruses to be exactly alive. We're going to say that viruses are probably incomplete living organisms, okay? Their names follow some other rules that are pretty much more flexible than those for naming the animals and the plants. The name of a genus is a noun in the singular number or a word that will be treated as such. It may be taken from any source, whatever. You're free to give the name you wish to any genus, okay? It must not necessarily make sense. You are again free, more or less, on that. Ideally, you want to say, give a name that is meaningful, but nobody holds you to do that. It should be adaptive to Latin and should not be too long. It should not be too long. And we have a few examples of animal genera on the board. It must be written as a single word, even if it was compounded. Okay? You cannot decide to make the scientific name of a genus or the name of a genus into two or three pieces or whatever. It must be a single name. And the names of subgenera will be treated exactly as if they were names of genera. Basically, they will follow exactly the same rules as far as even at the, to the level of homonymy, as far as homonymy is concerned. And then we get to the species name. And the Latinized part of the scientific name of a species will comprise two words, the generic name, and the second, which we call the specific name or epithet. And the epithet may be one of three types. We're not going to dwell too long into that, but they may be adjectives, and in that case, they must agree with the generic name in gender. They could be also genitive, or that is named after a country, a region, or a collector, or they could be a name, a noun in apposition, and that would be a noun that is treated as, or that is used as an adjective. Now, we talk first about the code of zoology, and that is the, well, we start with, sorry, we start with the, and the two terms have exactly the same acronym, the International Commission on Zoological Nomenclature. Okay? This is an organization that is dedicated to achieving stability and sense in the scientific naming of animals. It was founded in 1895 and currently comprises 27 members coming from 19 countries. The International Code of Zoological Nomenclature, or ICZN code, rules the formal scientific naming of organisms that will be treated as animals. I say organisms treated as animals, okay? And this is because right from the time of the five kingdom classification where we had the kingdom Protista, it was clear that the protozoans were no longer considered to be animals. And people used to call them the animal-like protista. And as such, all animals are considered to be, or are known to be, metazoans. There's no protozoan animal anymore by that classification. Are you still following me? Nobody stops me. It means, well, either they're not getting anything, or they're getting everything right. I hope it's the second. Good. So, the rules regulate the correct naming of animals, and will also arbitrate on the correct name to use in case of conflict, and they will indicate how scientific name, how scientific literature must cite scientific names or must use them. What are the principles of zoological nomenclature? My slide is a little crowded, but you probably want to retain essentially the first three words of every point on the board. The first of the principle is the principle of binomial nomenclature, and we've already discussed it. All the names, all the valid names, must be made up of two words. One is the genus name, the second is a species name. The second principle is called the principle of priority. Basically, if two names are published or are used, okay, the valid and the official name is the one that was the first one that was validly published. It may so happen that the first publication was done in a small or obscure journal. You may do it and publish it in the annals of the Faculty of Science of the University of Boya, and people don't get it, okay, until several years after, and then someone else has published, well, I would say, in Nature, and the name is known and adopted by everybody. But someday somebody will say, well, this was published validly, and the University of Boya, the annals, is a valid journal. And as such, you have priority, and it will be arbitrated by the commission, and eventually the name that was first published would be used. There may be exceptions to that, especially in the case where the change would bring more confusion than the status quo. And as such, the commission may have to rule on that. Okay? We are giving you the key principles, but some exceptions may be made for the purpose of maintaining order. Are we okay? The third principle is the principle of coordination. And this will say that within a family, genus, species, a name established for a taxon at any rank is simultaneously established with the same author and date. But this is exactly what this principle means. Okay? If Dave publishes or finds a new species and thinks that it belongs to a new genus, automatically he is also the authority of both the genus, the type genus, and the first species in that genus. If he had material and thought that it was a new family, he's also the author for both the family, the type genus, and the type species. That is understood. Nobody quarrels or asks questions about that. The third one is the principle of first revisor. Basically, two names may happen to be in use or to have been published at the same time or exactly around the same time. Or they were used initially thinking that they were two different species, and eventually for some reason, someone shows that these are designating the one and the same species, okay? Which of the two names is going to be the name for that species? Basically, I publish a paper where I describe two things, each with a different name. And later on, somebody shows that it was the same group of organisms that I described. Which of the two names stays? We're going to check in literature and see who is the first person to ever refer to that group and what name he used. The name that was first used to refer to it after the original author will have priority. That is the principle of first revisor, which comes to complement the principle of priority. Are we okay with that? Good. We're going to also have the principle of homonymy, saying that the name of each taxon must be unique. Consequently, a name that is a junior homonym must not be used. If there are two names, the one that was published after can be used maybe in your discussions at home, but you cannot use it in a formal forum. Okay? Yes, and finally we have the principle of typification, which basically says that each nominal taxon in the family group, genus group, or species group has a name-bearing type fixed. And we shall hear what the types are a little further. Now let's talk about the International Code of Nomenclature for algae, fungi, and plants. And we're going to note that the name, when the full name carries part of it, that does not start with capitals. Okay? And this was a decision of the International Committee on Botanical Taxonomy, or the Botanical Nomenclature. Okay? This code used to be called the International Code of Botanical Nomenclature until 2011, when it was replaced by the new code adopted in Melbourne by the Congress. And as with all the other codes, it takes effect as soon as it is approved, as soon as it is ratified by the Congress. The name of the code is partly capitalized and partly not. And the lowercase for algae, fungi, and plant indicate that these terms are not formal names of clades. And this is something important we're going to see. For instance, since that 2011, for instance, we say the name of plants or the classification of plants would end at the level